Lift up your hearts. Lift up the deepest places within you. Your deepest desires, your needs, your passions, your disappointments. However you find yourself, the Lord is with you. The Lord is with you.
Not a matter of life and death. It's not. Much more serious than that. So that's a play on words by a football coach. Way back when. By the way, who had a good day of football yesterday? Did you have fun? Did you have a good day of football? Okay. You had to stay up late to get there, huh? Anybody stay up late? All right. We're going to talk about something that it's actually more serious than life and death. In the ancient world, the students would follow a teacher, and the Jews called this teacher a rabbi, and they learned not only from the rabbi's words, okay, the rabbi would teach them words, but they'd learn from the rabbi's way of life. So they'd follow them around, and it wouldn't be just the rabbi was transferring information to them. It was really infusing a kind of character and a way of life into their way of living. And so Jesus was actually one of these kinds of teachers. Jesus didn't have a chalkboard. Jesus didn't have a whiteboard. Jesus didn't have a textbook. What Jesus had was a radical new way of life, and there were people that followed him around. His students or his disciples. Disciples might seem like a really churchy word. Disciples is actually just another word for student. And they would follow Jesus around, and they would learn not only what he did, but his inner character, why he did the things that he did, what motivated him to do the things he did, and they were absolutely transformed because of it. It's really it's a wild strategy if you think about it. Of all the things Jesus could have done, he chose to be a teacher who would have a few students who would learn how he did life, and they'd be transformed, and they'd go out and transform everything by it. And I got news for you this morning. I got news for you. Jesus is alive. The same Jesus is alive. And he sits at the right hand of God. And he has a body. And he sits at the right hand of God, and guess what he does? He reminds God of our weaknesses. And he reminds God of our frailty. And he reminds the Father that we really need him. We really need him deeply. And so it's that same Jesus that we can follow. You can be, I can be his student. We can be his disciple. And we can learn from him how to do as he did in life, but even more than that, how to take on his character. It's actually the best thing for us. It's the life that God has for us. Who wants the best life possible? That sounds like the name of a book. There has to be a book out there called that. I don't know of this. There has to be. The best life possible. Guess what Jesus' answer to that is? Follow me. There you go. There you go. Follow me. That's his answer to this. What is the best life possible? It's the reason why we're here. Lots of things we're called to do, right? In our individual lives. That's the reason you're here, I'm telling you this morning, is to be Jesus' disciple.
to follow him on a journey in this life and to continue to follow him on a journey in the next. Did you know that? You're going to continue to follow Jesus on this journey. And he's going to continue to pour into your life, but then you'll see him face to face. How about that? How about that day? So let's keep it simple this morning. Discipleship is a process of following Jesus and becoming more like him. And that's what the gospel is about. The gospel is about forgiveness of sins. But how many know that it doesn't stop there? The gospel is not only about forgiveness of sins. It's clearly about that, but it's forgiveness of sins so you can enter into a new kind of life, a life for which we were born, a conversational relationship with God, a two-way street. You can say things to him, and I think everybody does this at some point or another. Maybe even the most diehard atheist, I don't know, says things to him, but it's conversational. He can say things back to you, and you can enter into what's called his kingdom, giving you meaning, giving you purpose, giving you mission in life. Again, best kind of life that we can possibly have, where he transforms us from the inside out, and to commit every day, and this is an everyday commitment to being his disciple. That's the most radical, life-changing, urgent decision that we can make. It's not a matter of life and death. It's more important than that because it's a matter of abundance. It's a matter of transformation. It's a matter of eternity. How about that? It's a matter of eternity. And when you walk with Jesus, eternity begins when? Now, the moment you begin to walk with him, you're walking into eternity, and you're beginning to taste what eternal life is all about. When Jesus says, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly, abundant life and eternal life are the same thing. It's just that you can start to live into it now. All right, so that's the backdrop. We're going to look at a passage that can be confusing. It can be difficult. This passage we look at this morning may give you a jolt. So stay, make sure you got some elbow space away from your neighbor. Be careful. Be careful with the Bible. Bible's a book of love. It's a book of compassion. But it's not always safe in the way we want it to be safe. It can really challenge us. It can really give us a jolt. Amen? Anybody? You want to amen that? Yes. All right. That's courage. That's bravery to amen that statement. So we're going to look at a passage like that this morning. But we need to see that passage given and in light of what it is the life that Jesus has for us. This is all going to come together. This is going to make sense. We're starting with discipleship because that's the life that Jesus has for us. But in this passage, he wants us to see the reality of what it is to be his disciple. This thing of incomparable value to us, he wants us to see that in a world like ours, where there's brokenness, where there's temptation, where there's idols, things that can be false gods to us, that we have to make a radical decision. In order to have this life that he has for us, life of abundance with him, he wants us to see we have to make a radical decision that's going to cost us something. Now, that is a countercultural message by itself. We think the good life is just to skate through life somehow, to find whatever it is, that key, that silver bullet that's just going to allow us to skate through life easily with a smile on our face. Is there such thing? There is not. I actually see, I'll tell you what, I saw a little kid shaking his head no. I don't know whether that was really intended for me or whether that was perfect timing. I'm telling you, I saw a little kid shaking his head no. That's right. That kind of life's not available. But abundance is available, but Jesus wants us to see in this passage we're going to cover this morning that it's costly. It's costly. He wants us to see the gospel is not a feel-good, self-esteem program. That sounds nice. It's actually something much deeper than that. It's not something that's just going to cover up your woundedness and cover up your guilt. It's something that's going to dig deep into your life, and it's going to root that stuff out. So there may be pain, or there may even be suffering along the way. But Jesus is holding out the whole time this life of following him. That's the best thing for us. So we're going to continue our Christmas series this morning. We're celebrating Jesus. We're celebrating Jesus come to earth, and it's crazy times, you know, that there are angels appearing to people. And there are shepherds, these really downtrodden people, and they're being lifted up. And there are kings going mad and going crazy and doing immoral things. And there are magicians, wise men coming from the east because they're following a star. And there's these astronomical things that are happening. Why? What's going on in all of this? So we're going to ask that question in this series. And we're going to answer it through Jesus' words, his own words, why he's appeared on the scene. Why did Jesus come and wrap himself in human flesh? Utterly unexpected. That's an utterly unexpected story. It's part of the reason we know the gospel is true is it's so beautiful. It's such a beautiful, elegant solution to our sin problem. But it's also something we never would have predicted. We never would have expected it. He wraps himself in human flesh. Why? Last week we saw he came so he could call broken people. He could call downtrodden people, people who are at the end of their rope. And some of you this morning, you're feeling at the end of your rope. Maybe a day thing, maybe a week thing, maybe an entire season thing. You're feeling at the end of your rope. Jesus came to call you unto himself. That's one of the reasons all this crazy stuff happened. Angels appearing, stars, wise men, all this. He came to call the downtrodden, the broken. Today we're going to see Jesus came to offer us a radical decision. A radical decision. He came to offer you a radical decision between light and darkness, between real life and death in the soul, and between hope and despair. He came to make that decision a reality in our lives. Gonna be in Matthew 10. And I'm telling you, it's this serious. It's of the utmost seriousness and urgency. And so we're gonna start out in Matthew 10. Verse 1, we're just gonna set the stage here. Verse 1 says, Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority. He's beginning to transfer his authority to drive out impure spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. So what's going on? Here's the scene. Jesus has prepared this group of people. Okay, there are 12 people that are kind of the core, but Jesus had other disciples, men and women, if you look at the scriptures, disciples. Okay? And so he's prepared them, and now what's he doing? He's sending them out to do his work. The strategy that's going to sweep the entire world. Right? At the end of this, not the end of history, but the end of present history, is us sitting here and people like us sitting here this morning. He's starting his strategy. He's sending them out into the world. And he's readying them for this mission that he's going to give to them once he ascends back into heaven. And so he's the great teacher. He's the great rabbi. He's going to give them some instructions. He's going to say, I'm sending you out. Here's what I would have you to do. And the first thing he says, this would be such a hard thing. This would be such a hard first instruction for modern people. Don't take a suitcase. Can you imagine? Like, can you go away for a night without filling up the trunk? Because my wife and I cannot. Got to have the pillows, got to have the fan for the white noise. Like, you got to have all this stuff. Jesus says, don't take your fan. Don't worry about the white noise. In fact, don't even worry about a change of clothes, because you're going to rely on the goodwill of the people to whom you go. And if they're responsive to you, if they accept you, give your blessing to them. If they don't, what's he say? Shake the dust off your feet. Shake the dust off your feet. Those can both be hard, by the way. Giving your blessing and learning when to shake the dust off your feet. And he says, proclaim the gospel boldly. Don't worry about people, whether or not they approve of you, whether or not they dig this message you're giving them. Don't worry about that. That's a tough one too. So it's don't take your suitcase. Don't worry what people think about you. Those are tough. Because then you got to really rely on God. You've really got to trust him. When you don't take your suitcase, you're not worried about what people think of you. And he says over and over, don't be afraid. That's easier said than done. If I get up here and say, I want you to go out and preach the gospel, don't take anything with you. You're going to rely on the goodwill of other people. It'll be fine. Don't be afraid. I don't have the authority to do that. You really ought not listen to me. Jesus has the authority to do this. Jesus is the man who can tell you, go out, don't take a suitcase, don't worry what happens to you. Why? Because I can take care of you. So Jesus tells him that. And then he says in verse 34, this is our primary passage, okay? Verse 34 to 39. He says, he's told him all this stuff, and then he says this. Just get this. Imagine. Put yourself in the story. Imagine this. Do not suppose I've come to bring peace to earth. That's comforting. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against, he's quoting one of the prophets here, a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be members of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. Does anybody have this passage committed to memory? Did you memorize this one? And in your darkest moment, you come out with this. I just remember that Jesus said, I came not to bring peace, but a sword. Well, actually, believe it or not, because of the parallelism, this is not my idea. Scholars have determined the parallelism you see and the structure in these verses, Jesus actually intended for them. This was so important, what he was saying to them. He intended for them to memorize it, to commit it to memory, to remember this. All these wonderful things he says. This one, the structure is set up for them to be able to memorize it. So there you go. There you go, everybody. The disciples, they're already on edge. They're already on edge. Jesus has spoken about persecution. He's spoken about threats of death. And instead of trying to assuage or calm their concerns and calm their fears, he doubles down. Think he's just trying to freak them out? Is he just uncaring? I doubt it. Jesus sees that what they're going to need for this road ahead is reality. One of the ways we can love other people is by bringing them into a little place called reality. Amen. It can be difficult. It's one of the ways we can love people, showing them truth and showing them reality, because he wants them to know. This is a radical message that you're taking to people. This is a wonderful message you're taking to people. But guess what? It is not going to sit well with everybody. Not everybody's going to like what you have to say. It's going to provoke violence, because some people are going to feel, they're going to feel threatened by it. And so it's not saying he just came to bring conflict for conflict's sake. Because, hey, I'm Jesus, I can do it. I get people riled up. It's not the idea. It's saying, this message is going to have that effect when you really devote your life to it, and you need to know that. You need to know that. Why? People don't want to hear that they're not in control of their own lives, even if it's good for them. Do you agree with Jesus on this? People don't want to hear that they're not in control of their own lives, even if that's good for them to hear. They don't want to hear that eternal things are more important than their stuff or even their relationships. They don't want to hear that, even if it's good for them to hear that. Some people just, they're not going to want to know that. They're not going to want to hear that sacrificing things is better than indulgence. Isn't that a wonderful, wouldn't that make a great commercial during halftime? when every commercial is about indulgence, you get on there and say, ah, life is actually about sacrifice, giving things up, rather than indulgence. Think of what they charge you for that slot. So they don't want to hear that. Some people are not going to want to hear that giving away things is better than consuming everything that we can. Some people are going to want to hear that avoiding temptation is better than giving into it. That real life is more about other people than it is about you. Some people are not going to want to hear this, that you have to ask forgiveness for things. Some people aren't going to like that. The gospel's pointed, it's radical, it's piercing, and it's going to provoke anger, and it's going to provoke violence, even to the point of breaking and severing these deepest relational ties that you have, maybe even your family ties. And I wonder if some people here have experienced conflict or tension in your families because of Jesus Christ. And there was a story that was very prominent about 5 or 10 years ago of a girl who was a Muslim, converted to Christianity, ends up having to flee her family and hide from them. Do you remember this? Because they were threatening her. Because the actual threats against her life that she was receiving. And so Jesus says, I came not to bring peace, but to bring a sword. And we know that, you know, the Messiah was going to be characterized by peace. And that's consistent with what Jesus is saying here. Because Jesus is saying, there is no such thing as a cheap peace. There is no such thing as peace between you and other people where you just sweep conflict under the rug. Or you give in to them and you give up devotion to the things that matter most. There's no such peace as that. You agree with that? There's no easy peace. So I came not to bring peace, but a sword. And so to follow Jesus is to accept this kind of response, this violent kind of response in some people. But guess what? Sometimes even your family. Sometimes even family. These deepest kind of ties we have. Sometimes even family. But guess what? If you flip over to Matthew 12, starting in verse 46, it says, while Jesus was still talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside wanting to speak to him. Okay? At this point, it's likely they think he's gone a little crazy. They think he's gone crazy. Okay? And so they're going to try to rein him in. That's kind of the understanding. So what's Jesus say? Someone says to him this, yes. He replied to him, who is my mother and who are my brothers? Pointing to his disciples, he said, here are my mother and my brothers. He's probably pointing to this wider group of disciples right now that's larger than the 12. Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Here's the good news. Yes, there's a reality in this passage, but Jesus does not leave you alone. He gives you a new family. He gives all of us a new family. Guess who that is? Look around you, because it's the church. It's the church that he's given to us that replaces these ties that have been severed. And so we share Jesus, even though the gospel's going to cause conflict, even though not everybody's going to want to hear it. And you might be called to die for it. Just keeps getting better. You might be called to die for it. Now, that's kind of foreign to us because we tend to think of Christianity as a Western phenomenon. Guess what? There are now more Christians in the Southern Hemisphere than there are in the West. Christianity has become a Southern Hemisphere phenomenon. And we're going to need them. Thank God for what he's doing in the church in the Southern Hemisphere, because we are going to need them. You know that? We're going to need them ourselves. And so it's not foreign. This idea that they might die for the faith, that is not foreign to Christians around the globe. Persecution has gotten much worse in the country of China, to the point now churches are being surveilled. There's surveillance in churches. So imagine if we want to meet in a public space, you wonder why so many churches are going underground. If we want to meet in a public space, we'd have to have cameras up. and then watching everything we're doing and hearing everything we're saying. How about that? You know, we have to deal with that kind of thing. But when Jesus talks about taking up the cross, whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me, he's talking about a devotion that will rather face death than turn aside from him. It's easy to say, you know, oh yeah, I'd face death for Jesus. Of course I would. But then you think about these little things that really freak us out, we get really afraid of. I used to run a lot, and I was terrified of dogs chasing me because I heard a story about a dog biting off someone's entire calf once. So I thought, wow, okay, good. So that's terror, you know? I think Christians face lions who were, right? There's this mid-sized dog coming at me when I'm running out in the country. I don't know what's going to happen. I never got bit once. Got chased a lot. Never got bit once. They were definitely going to get eaten. That was going to happen to them. You think about that. What about those sounds in the night? Do you ever get creeped out by those sounds in the night? What is it? What is that I hear in the basement? And should I go down there? So you grab your baseball bat and tiptoe down there, whatever. Like, we have fear. And so it's quite a thing for Jesus to say, you got to have a kind of devotion that outbalances this fear of death that we all have. So devotion unto death, and this idea of the cross, wow, would that have made the disciples shudder? Like, we lose the context of that either. We're talking the most brutal, the most horrific kind of death you can die. But even more than that, because you got to think, this is a shame and honor culture. You are really shamed by the whole cross spectacle. You got to take one of the beams and you got to walk through the city with it while people are ridiculing you. And it was typically hanging on the cross. Crucifixion was typically reserved for criminals. So if you were a free person, wow, the disgrace, the horror, just the savage, brutal death that this is. Jesus says, you're going to have to be willing to endure social stigma, being an outcast, and possibly even death. The person who's willing to do that is the person who is worthy of Jesus. Worthy not in the sense of we're earning anything. Worthy in this context just means you have what it takes. God's prepared your heart such that you're ready for this. All right, so let's sum it up. Discipleship is not a matter of life and death. It's actually much more serious than that. Jesus came to give us a radical decision. A radical decision that we can make for him, no matter the cost, because we've found something that's much, much better. And actually, he closes it. There are hints of hope. There are tones of hope. You're a disciple. You've got this passage memorized because Jesus is loving you right now by giving you a dose of reality, and he wants you to know. But then he closes with this. Whoever finds their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for my sake will what? You'll find it. You will find it. He's contrasting your earthly life. It's transient. It's passing. It's fading away, and we cannot give too much weight. Life matters, right? On the Christian view, this life here matters deeply. But you can't give too much weight to this earthly life, he wants to say. Because there's real life. The word life here is actually the word psyche. Remember what the word psyche? But in the Bible, what it meant, real life, the real thing. Same thing, abundant life, eternal life, real life. Same thing. There's eternity. So here's what I want to leave you with. I'll leave you with four questions, okay? Four questions. These are Christmas questions. Might not sound like it. Jesus has given us a dose of reality this morning. This is part of why he came, we would ask questions like this of ourselves. So Merry Christmas. These are Christmas questions. Are you ready? All right. Am I ready? Am I ready to choose Jesus over the stuff of modern living? Did a little research, meaning I Googled things. I did a lot of real research for this sermon. This part I Googled, because I figured there was something out here like this, and there is. There's a new term for a growing fear. Nomophobia. You know what nomophobia is? I can't. That was all one mumble. I'm sorry. I'm going to assume you got it right, but I'm going to tell you. No mobile phone phobia. Did you get that? Raise your hand. Is that what somebody said? No mobile phone phobia. Real researchers, like real doctors are using this, okay? Nomophobia. You don't have your cell phone. And 2/3 of us suffer from it. We're afraid. You know, you see that. It gets down to 3%. And you're out. And you don't have a charger. Nomophobia. That's nomophobia. We're consumers. We're trained to be this way. We are trained to be this way. And if you think, oh, I watch commercials and I just wait through them so I get back to whatever it is I was watching, we're all affected by it. You gotta have your eyes wide open in society, everybody. You gotta have our eyes wide open. We're all affected by consumerism. And what is the heart of consumerism is you no longer just own stuff that you use for various things with which God has blessed you. You no longer own stuff. Your stuff owns you. Your stuff owns you, and you obsess over it, and you think about it, and you're passionate about the next thing you're gonna get. We all have stuff like this, where we're looking on Amazon, we're looking on reviews, and then we're Googling, like, the best blah, 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 blah of 2019, or whatever, because you gotta make sure, you know. Our stuff can begin to own us. It can even cause relational conflict. Relational conflict over stuff. Here's a term I think we need to begin to apply to this way of life and sear it into our consciousness. This is normalized insanity. It's normalized insanity. This insane and petty way of living has become normal for all of us. I'm not up here pointing the finger. I'm with you. I'm with you. We all have to recognize this. We're obsessed with getting stuff. Stuff can become an idol, can become a god in our lives. And I'll tell you, if any of us, people here of humble means, you feel like I'm a person of humble means, this doesn't apply to me. In a global sense, we've all got a fair amount of stuff, everybody. We do. This isn't a rich person disease. This is part of what it is to be an American. There's a lot good about that. This isn't a guilt trip. This isn't a guilt trip us for where we were born or who we are. It's to say when we follow Jesus, we got to have our eyes wide open and be aware the kind of society we're in. So we ask ourselves, do I own my stuff or does my stuff own me? And be honest about that. Am I more concerned with consuming things than I am with the spread of the kingdom of God? Do I think about what I need more than who I need? Capital W. Can I practice frugality? Can I practice generosity? Am I ready to choose Jesus over all the stuff of modern living so that what? So I can trust him for what I need. Don't take a suitcase. Can I trust him for what I need? That's question one. Question two, Christmas, Merry Christmas, Christmas questions. Am I ready to choose Jesus over the approval of other people? It's okay. It's okay to want to do well. It's okay to feel good when other people encourage you. That's why they're doing it. The approval of people can control us. Yes? Yes. The approval of people can absolutely control us. We can want it so badly, we let it drive us over our love of God and our desire to walk faithfully with him. The approval of others can be that strong a force in our lives. And we can want it so badly that we are willing to compromise our devotion to Jesus. Either because people are pulling us astray, that's one way. We want their approval so badly, we're doing things we ought not to do, or we're just so worried about their approval that we forget what we really need. The only person's approval who matters is God's. And the only person who can really give us actual value and actual meaning is God. You hearing me on this? You hearing me this morning? Merry Christmas, are you hearing me? The only person who can give us absolute value is God. So we're ready to call out to him this Advent and say, I'm waiting on you for that worth that I want so badly, for that acceptance that I want so badly, for that unconditional love that I want so badly. I'm waiting on you this Advent. Question 3. Am I ready to choose Jesus over the fullness of my calendar? Say this a lot up here. You and I wear busyness like a badge of honor. It's really probably not. We run until we drop. We chase events until we don't even know why we're doing what we're doing sometimes. Does that ever happen in your household? It's not even clear to you why you're doing what you're doing anymore. You're just doing very quickly, scurrying. Well, Jesus is asking his disciples to face opposition and maybe even death. I wonder if, given the weightiness of those things, we could at least just begin to give our calendar and surrender our calendar over to Jesus and say, how do you want me to plug into the lives of other Christians? How do you want me to plug into the lives of those who really need to know Christ? And what does that imply for my priorities and what I do with my time? He's asking people to be ready to die. I wonder if we could do this lesser thing. What do you think? Question 4. Am I ready? And this one's actually related to question 2, but I think it's distinct. Am I ready to choose Jesus over my relationships? Because our relationships, if we make those the most important thing, we destroy them. Because you're putting all your stock, you're putting all your need for approval, all your need for values on another person, and that is patently unfair to them. Because they cannot provide that. So when we make our spouses or our friends or our children or our family the most important thing, we make them into idols. The way to save relationships, the way to see relationships flourish is that Christ is at the center of them. I know that sounds simple, everybody, but Christ is in the center of them, and Christ is the most important thing. And you're pouring into that person's well-being because you know God wants good for him or her, not just because you want something good from that person. So are we ready to do this? Are we ready to choose Jesus over everything else because what he offers is so good? And do we see it this Christmas? Do we see the goodness, the absolute goodness of what it is he offers? And so I'm going to leave you with this. I'm going to leave you with this image to dwell on. While we're asking ourselves, are we ready to make this radical decision? Go a little further into the book of Matthew, chapter 13, verse 44. These are the words of Jesus himself. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and he, in his joy, went and sold all that he had." All that he had. He bought that field. So Lord, may we know the goodness of what it is you offer today, this Advent season. Lord, sear it into our hearts. Show us your goodness. Show us your beauty all over again. We wait on that. And that drives us, Lord, that drives us to make a radical decision to say yes to you each and every day. Give us the courage, give us the strength, give us the humility, give us what we need to say yes to you. We pray because, Lord, we need your help. We need your help. We need your guidance. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.